think the whole point of this, if I had to use one sentence summary, which I am forcing myself to do right now, which, how can one force oneself if I am not two? Good evening, everybody. If you like Greek myths, then this is your episode. Now, like all great stories, Pinocchio, Hansel and Gretel, from more modern to medieval to ancient stories, it's really hard to draw the line between the conscious construction and creation of it versus its roots, I'm trying to do hand movements, its roots in our prehistoric oratorical origins, campfire stories. Tonight is the myth or story from Sophocles of Oedipus, and naturally, as my inclination is to find out more and more about our psychology, I'm going to talk about its intimate connection with the Oedipal complex, and on a more broader scale, what myths and stories can mean for informing how you and I can live. Now, with any luck, this time I have my focus set so you're not constantly seeing me switching places with my books. Alright, so the Oracle of Delphi. The Oracle of Delphi tells King Laus of Thebes that he'll have a child who's destined to kill him. And not just that, but sleep with his wife, Jocasta, the boy's own mother. When a baby comes along and the king pierces his ankles and leaves him on a mountainside to die. A shepherd finds the baby, though, and takes him to King Polybus and Queen Merope of Corinth, who name him Oedipus and raise him as their own. And then one day, Oedipus goes to the Oracle of Delphi to find out who his real parents are. The Oracle doesn't see fit to tell him this, but she does tell him that he's destined to kill his father and sleep with his mother. Oedipus tries to run from this fate, but ends up running right into it. He kills Laus in a scuffle at the crossroads, not knowing he's his real dad. Later, he wins the throne of Thebes and unknowingly marries his own mother. After answering the riddle of the Sphinx, several years and several children later, Oedipus and Jocasta figure out the truth of everything with the unwilling help of Tiresias, the seer. Jocasta hangs herself, and Oedipus stabs out his own eyes. The blind king then goes into exile with his only daughter, Antigone, to guide him, and then eventually dies in the town of Colonus. So that's the myth in a nutshell, and the reason I gave you only the summary was that there's a really interesting article about myth and psychology. Myth and psychology. Featuring the theories of the Viennese psychologist. He was primarily a physician. Sigmund Freud, who died in 1939, and the Swiss psychiatrist Carl Gustav Jung, who I'm growing increasingly interested in based on his choice to study such a broad scope of human history and specifically mythology, and how mythology and religion intertwine with this with the innate psychological structures of our brain that are universal, that he calls the archetypes. So the theories of these two, Jung and Freud, have almost monopolized the study of myth. And Freud's key discussion of his key myth, that of Oedipus, fittingly occurs in the interpretation of dreams. For he and Jung as well compare myths with dreams. Myths with dreams, with dreams, with dreams, with dreams. Now on the surface, or our manifest level, the story of Oedipus describes the figure's vain effort to elude the fate that has been imposed on him. Latently, however, Oedipus most wants to do what manifestly he least wants to know. He wants to act out his Oedipus complex, the manifest or literal level of the myth hides the latent symbolic meaning. On the manifest level, Oedipus is the innocent victim of fate. Of course, the oracle should have told him maybe who his real parents were, and thereby you can argue he would have avoided the entire debacle. On the latent level, though, he is the culprit. His specific actions to duel and kill this king and marry and usurp the kingdom, the throne, and as a result of that, take along the responsibilities of a king. In tradition would have it that he would marry the deposed king's wife or his mother. So he is the culprit on the latent level. And rightly understood, the myth depicts not Oedipus's failure to circumvent his ineluctable destiny, but his success in fulfilling his fondest desires. The latent meaning scarcely stops here. For the myth is not ultimately about Oedipus at all. It's just as the manifest level on which Oedipus is the victim masks a latent one on which Oedipus is the victimizer. So that level in turn masks an even more latent one on which the ultimate victimizer is the myth maker, and any reader of the myth smitten with it. Either is an adult, a neurotic adult male, stuck or fixated at his Oedipal stage of development. He identifies himself with Oedipus and through him fulfills his own Oedipal complex. At heart, the myth is not biography, but an autobiography. So, another famous psychoanalyst, the Austrian Otto Rank, died in 1939 as well, who was Freud's protege at the same time, but later broke irrevocably with his... Mic drop. With his master, works out a common plot or a pattern for a key category of myths, those of male heroes. The heart of the pattern is the decision by the parents to kill their son at birth to avert the prophecy that the son, if born, will one day kill his own father. Unbeknownst to the parents, though, the infant is rescued and raised by others, grows up to discover who he is, returns home to kill his father, and succeeds him as king or noble. Now, interpreted psychologically, the pattern is the enactment of Oedipus and the complex. The son kills his father to gain sexual access to his mother. Mainstream psychoanalysis has changed mightily since Freud's day. Contemporary psychoanalysts like the American Jacob Arlow, who died in 2004, see myth as contributing to normal development, though, rather than to the perpetuation of a neuroses. Myth abets adjustment to the social and physical worlds rather than childish flight from them. So abets, I gotta look that up. I guess that means helps. Encourages, okay. Abet is to encourage or assist someone to do something wrong, in particular to commit a crime. Okay. So myth abets adjustment to the social and physical worlds rather than the childish flight from them. Furthermore, myth now serves everyone, not merely the neurotics. The classical Freudian goal is the establishment of oneself in the external world, largely free of domination by parents and instincts. Success is expressed concretely in the form of a job and a mate. Jungians accept that goal, but as that of only the first half of life, the first half in quotes, or from infancy to young adulthood. Now the goal of, and I think that's where the Nietzschean influence on Jung really kicks in, it's that camel, lion, child, archetypal pattern of growth intellectually, where the camel carries the most burden. That's the physical and fundamental psychological growth. The lion is almost the culmination of the I guess the actual climax of the abilities of that growth. Physically, more so than mentally. And then the child, the transition from lion to child, is one of rare actual manifestation in the real world. Whereas where your ego ultimately incorporates your place in the actual social, cultural, historical structure that you're sitting within, and you recognize that you are master of your own personal domain. But in order to do anything outside your own domain, interact with others in the world, you have to accept your limitations as a finite being in the world, and check your ego, I guess, really is what it is. Point being, you develop such a powerful one of the most powerful tools in your psyche at that point of the transition to childhood again is that you can, in fact, incorporate data into your life that doesn't fit with what you know. So you're able to maintain your own awareness of your abilities in the face of something you don't understand. But I should not have gone on that tangent, because I did not know what I was talking about completely. I was just trying to think aloud, trying to synthesize these two ideas, I guess. Okay. So we left off before I made a fool of myself. The goal of the uniquely Jungian second half of life, of adulthood, is consciousness, not, however, of the external world, as summed up by the Freudian term reality principle, but of the distinctively Jungian, or collective unconscious. One must return to that unconscious from which one has unavoidably become severed in the first half of your life. But not to sever one's ties to the external world. On the contrary, the aim is to return in turn to the external world. The ideal is balance between consciousness of the external world and consciousness of the unconscious. The aim of the second half of life is to supplement, not abandon, the achievements of the first half. And, I'm working my way through the genealogy of morals right now, and as someone who's not being formally, or hasn't been formally trained in philosophy, and, you know, maybe it's ultimately going to be better for me, because I don't have a rigid structure in which to put my ideas, so maybe I might see things from a different light, but probably not, because it's a little more chaotic to approach it this way. So there's probably a lot of things that a good philosophy professor could in fact teach me or guide me in the direction of observing before I'm conscious of it. But nonetheless, it's really fascinating that, I won't go into it right now, but one of Nietzsche's ideas is that the reason laws and myths and traditions are so important is that they enable us to have a predictability about society. They enable a kind of relative stasis, so that change doesn't happen too chaotically, too dramatically, and there's an underlying order to how human beings operate. You know, for instance, the 5-day work week, the general fact that we work during the day and sleep at night, that's traditionally, culturally enforced almost. Not everyone does it, and that's the point, is that you want a balance between those two. That's probably a really bad example, but just almost anything you do, like having breakfast, 3 meals a day, and then of course I'm trying to think of things that aren't law, explicitly law, like stop signs, following driving, and, you know, not physically harming other people. These things help us because they are a relative, in a small period of time, a constant that we can use as a baseline to predict the future. And by predicting the future, I mean of our personal actions. Actions so that we can make promises. I'm gonna try to avoid making a fool of myself twice. Okay. So, basically the significance of our ability to make promises is that A, we need a powerful memory, a will that an event won't be forgotten, and confidence in our ability to predict the future. And that's significant because laws and traditions, like I'm talking about, allow us to be predictable, and therefore we can assume responsibility of our promises and our ability to fulfill them. And this allows the existence of a sovereign or free individual. So through a complex analysis, it sounds ironic, but the instantiation of rules in a society, whether it's explicit in law or implicit in culture, such as, you know, free speech, let someone speak, and, you know, don't punch someone in the face without letting them to speak first, I guess, as a very crude example. Trying to think of some other stuff. I'm so immersed in it that I can't detach myself and see it. Like in my room. Well, I mean, the fact that we wear clothes, you know, is one thing. I don't know, maybe waving to someone. That's something that, you know, you just say, we just do it to be nice, because not everybody does it. But the fact that a lot of people do it is evidence of some sort of implicit agreement, you know, that if we're neighbors and I ask to borrow a cup of coffee, it's implied that there'll be a little bit of acknowledged debt to you, and in the future you can cash in on that debt to a similar extent. But we need rules like this to create a sovereign individual, so that if it was chaotic, you might not be able to predict the future, and you might not, in the sense that society wouldn't necessarily be probable to still exist in the same fashion that it currently does. So therefore, you wouldn't be able to predict that in the future, I will have a cup of sugar, I will have a job, my family will still be together, to be able to give you and have the assets to return the favor. And so society at large is composed and very organized and very rigid, roughly, because of that reason. Because it allows us to say, okay, it's stable. In 5 years from now, I will still be alive. Because if anything, I have the welfare system to back me up. Or I have my neighbors or my family or something like that. Or I have just the general good nature or goodwill of other citizens that isn't necessary from a very, very objective standpoint, but in fact is necessary if you want to continue to play the game of stable organization we call a society over a long period of time with as many people as possible. The reciprocation of debts and credits and general good nature is a key factor of that. And the sovereign individual has tremendous responsibility then to make claims about their future actions. So if I know society is going to be relatively stable, and therefore I know that, okay, I can promise you something, then it's my fault if I don't act out and fulfill that promise in the future, and therefore it's my personal responsibility to avoid shirking that owed debt, I guess. And we call this sense of responsibility, according to Nietzsche, our conscience. So our conscience, he tried to bury very, very deep into millennia of history and prehistory with human beings and derive where our sense of conscience comes from. That was a terrible explanation, I know, but hey, you know, I'm just trying to flesh out my own ideas. So let's see if I can incorporate that into what we're learning about Jungian theory, about breaking out from that stabilized society and doing something very personal and individual, and or not breaking out, because you're becoming a part of it. But if you're individualizing yourself by choosing a specific job and choosing a specific mate, and then you're like a specific example of a very general concept that includes getting a job and choosing a mate and fitting into somewhere into the structure of society. And so Jung says the second part of your life, once you've established yourself as an individual in society, then the second part is to return . So, let's see. All right. So this is where Joseph Campbell, the American mythologist who died in 1987, provides the classical Jungian counterpart to Rank on hero myths, where Rank's pattern, limited to males, centers on the hero's toppling of his father. Campbell's centers on a journey, and anybody who's taken college English 101, you know, will have, you know, watched Star Wars or The Hobbit or something like that, to give them a modern day example of how pervasive and ubiquitous really this idea of a hero's journey really is. And the hero with a thousand faces, that's why that book was so popular by Joseph Campbell, was because almost any story that ages well and is popular will have some variant of this myth, but the variant can't vary too much, because there are certain core aspects of the journey that everybody must go through in order to live a fulfilled life, a meaningful one at that. So let's try to flesh this out. Campbell's centers on a journey undertaken by an adult female or male hero from the known human world to the heretofore unknown world of gods. Interpreted psychologically, that journey is an inner, not outer, trek from the known portion of the mind, ordinary or ego consciousness, the object of which is the external world, to the unknown portion in the mind, the Jungian unconscious. The successful hero must not only reach the strange new world, but also he must also return. So it's I guess the alternative would be to either descend into madness and or become such a perverse new version of ourselves that our old selves would have completely rejected us, which might be a form of madness. In psychological terms, success means the completion of the goal of the second half of life. So the most influential Jungian theorist of myth after Jung himself was Erich Neumann, his protege, who died in 1960, and James Hillman, which I recommend looking him up on YouTube. There's a lot of really profound lectures and more casual talks by Hillman that you can find on YouTube. There, hours and hours of it, about alchemy as well. So Jung, Neumann systematizes the developmental or evolutionary aspect of Jungian theory, which is why I like Jordan Peterson so much, because Jordan Peterson he's just so well read, and he pulls from so many different areas and science and evolutionary theory and science as well, is a big part of why he is so confident that he's correct about essentially his whole idea, is that taking on as much responsibility is kind of what, you know, Nietzsche is saying, really, but he's trying to prove it psychometrically, or psychologically, using psychometrics and other areas of science. His idea is that the best way to live, or the best life, is a life that has the most profound meaning. And to get meaning, and profound meaning at that, you must take on as much responsibility as you can. And even if you don't believe in objective meaning in a million years from now, your life will be forgotten in a billion years from now, or 10 billion, our star will have already exploded, and perhaps our civilization, our species, our whole earth would have been forgotten. As Nietzsche said, in a momentary, a few momentary breaths of the universe, our society, our civilization, our earth will have evolved and destroyed life. And at the end of it, nothing will have been done. So you can take that perspective and wallow in the meaninglessness, the nihilism of it, or you can acknowledge that when you feel sad, it's because, well, I don't know why it's because specifically, but the fact that you feel sad and you feel happy and you have emotions tells you that your brain values different things. And when you really ask, that unconscious that lies within us all, that archetypal mind that we all have, that we all share, from what Jung and Nietzsche and Peterson believe is our evolutionary history, is a desire to develop our character and our physical abilities, go out and find something new and explore and experience and create even something new out of all the chaos that we don't know. Chaos being a very general term for things that aren't within your current understanding of the world. And it could be your next door neighbor's room, or your living room or something, you know, because if you've never been over there, you don't understand it, let alone their mind, because certainly we don't understand our own. There's no way we could understand them. And without rambling too much to get off my point, meaning comes from developing your skills to the point that you can confront the unknown without breaking down and without cowering away from it. So you don't want to jump into it too deep. You want to walk that yin-yang sign between order and chaos. Have one foot in order, something you're very, very comfortable with, but it's boring and it's prone to tyranny and stasis. And then you want to have one foot in chaos, the unknown, the thing that can perhaps bring new and better ideas to the order, yet also has the potential for infinite, you know, regression into a black hole of chaos and negative disintegration of order, you know, which wouldn't be good. You need some order. So his whole idea of what it makes life the most meaningful, and it is almost infinitely embedded in our myths, our deepest myths, from Mesopotamia to Egypt to Greek to Judeo-Christian Old Testament myths, to Indian myths, Chinese myths, Asian myths, you know, Native American myths, is that you want to be the individual who has disciplined themselves enough to be able to go out, confront the unknown, create something out of it, and bring it back to help their community. Because we are fundamentally social creatures, and we get meaning out of communication and interaction and development of relationships between each other. So yeah, that's why this all interests me, because science tells us that when I drop this book, gravity will make it fall at an accelerated rate to ridiculous precision. Science tells us these things, and this microphone and the computer and the cell phone I'm recording on are only able to exist because of what we know about electricity, electromagnetism, and even quantum mechanics is an integral part of all this. So, you know, not just capacitors and resistors and you know, batteries, but also more complex quantum mechanical level stuff like op amps, which are fundamentally a bunch of transistors arranged in a very specific way. In a transistor, I heard one of my professors say, a transistor in 1,000 years, to, you know, he's an electrical engineer, he's a doctorate, so of course he's a little biased, but he says that in 1,000 years, they're going to look back and say the most breakthrough important development, technological development of that civilization, our civilization, will be the transistor. So go look that up if you're technically interested in that. But that's the whole point, is that of what Peterson's saying, is that technology gives us all these things, but what we choose to do with it is in fact a whole separate domain of exploration and intellectual their pursuits worthwhile. Because his main idea of, you can have a field, but the field itself, you can know an infinite number of facts about that field, and all those facts themselves don't tell you how to walk through it. You can have an infinite number of ways to walk through it. It's a little shadier on this side, less lines on this side. There's not a huge pit in the middle of, you know, if you take the middle road or something like that. But I guess the point is that religion and science, or at least myths and tradition and culture and science, are the opposite of opposites. In fact, they're integral, and we need them to develop as a society and to find meaning in our life. We need each other. We need traditions and myths to help inform our everyday interactions, or else you'd literally not have any time to explore fringe concepts of science and philosophy if you were worried about whether my neighbor was going to wave to me or shoot a gun at me tomorrow. You need stabilizing culture. You need enforced, culturally enforced principles of morality, of how to act. You know, like if I saw a video the other day on Reddit about, it looked like it was in Asia maybe, some two guys in biker helmets walked up to a lady walking with her little, like a three-year-old daughter, and they didn't, they basically tried to take the kid, and the lady ran across the street, yanked him out of their hands, but they weren't like being extremely forceful because there were a ton of people around. They were on a main busy, a busy main road, and the exact justification of why we should have cultural norms and agreed upon ubiquitous morals is that she walked across the street, a truck of, it looked like a fire truck, might have been like a medical, like an EMT truck or something, but they got out and chased the guys. So yeah, sorry, that was a long tangent, but I think I never realized that psychology, Jung and Freud and Nietzsche had, and all these other guys, Adler, Neumann, Rank, Joseph Campbell, I never realized they had permeated, penetrated so far into understanding our psyche. Like, and I always thought it was just boring, you know, like that guy, with the dogs and the bells, Pavlov. I thought it was like interesting experiments, but they never had an agreed upon theory behind it. And I guess there are a lot of maybe contradictory theories, but at the same time, there are a lot of broader, deeper theories that are verified, or at least found, variants of them are found in myths. So it's interesting that science can is still trying to keep up with some of the wisdom of some of the oldest myths that we have. So back from the detour, I don't know why I really just use this as an outlet to talk to myself, and I'm just so grateful that at least that even one or two of you enjoy some of these topics, some of these subjects. So to finish this up, by far the most radical development in the Jungian theory of myth has been the emergence of archetypal psychology, which in fact considers itself post-Jungian. In fact, the chief figure in this movement is James Hillman. Another important figure is David Miller. Archetypal psychology faults classical Jungian psychology on multiple grounds. By emphasizing the compensatory therapeutic message of mythology, classical Jungian psychology purportedly reduces mythology to psychology and gods to concepts. And espousing a unified self, or self with a capital S, as the ideal psychological authority, Jungian psychology supposedly projects onto psychology a Western, specifically monotheistic, more specifically Christian, even more specifically Protestant outlook. That's like a sentence I would have written. The Western emphasis on progress is purportedly reflected in the primarian Jungian, in the primacy Jungian psychology. Accords hero myths. In the primacy, it accords the ego. This is a weird sentence. I'm really having trouble reading it. The Western emphasis on progress is purportedly reflected in the primacy Jungian psychology accords hero myths, and the primacy it accords the ego. Even in the ego's encounter with the unconscious, the encounter is intended to abet or aid development. I don't know why they keep it. Abet seemed like a negative connotation, but maybe that's newer. So, and finally, Jungian psychology is berated for placing archetypes in an unknowable realm, distant from the known realms of symbols. As a corrective, Hillman and his followers advocate that psychology be viewed as irreducibly mythological. Myth is still to be interpreted psychologically, but psychology itself is to be interpreted mythologically. One grasps the psychological meanings of the myth of Saturn by imagining oneself to be the figure Saturn, not by translating Saturn's plight into clinical terms like depression. Moreover, the depressed Saturn represents a legitimate aspect of one's personality. Each god deserves its due. The psychological idea should be pluralistic rather than monolithic. In mythological terms, polytheistic rather than monotheistic. Or Greek rather than biblical. Which is a fascinating topic in itself. I won't go. Insisting that archetypes are to be found in symbols rather than outside them, Hillman espouses a relation to the gods in themselves and not something beyond them. The ego becomes but one more archetype with its attendant kind of god, and it is the soul rather than the ego that experiences the archetypes through myths. Myths serve to open up one's soul, to open one up to the soul's own depths. Okay. I think the whole point of this, if I had to use one sentence summary, which I am forcing myself to do right now, which... How can one force oneself if I am not two? Is that our minds operate on so many levels. From, if I ask you to remember this number, 739846, you do. That's probably the highest level, I think. The most surface level, rather. Because highest might mean most valuable, but that's not what I mean. I guess the highest to lowest. The lowest value would be the deepest, most emotional, most reptilian, deepest, oldest evolutionarily. And we simply don't have any unified theory, just like gravity versus strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces. So myth is still one of the best ways, or no, according to this article, it is the best way to still explain, or at least help understand better what our deepest drives and complex cacophonies of forces contributing to our life decisions are. So I think myth and psychology and the study of them both is immensely helpful to not just understand yourself, but when you do understand yourself, it's helpful to, well, it's helpful to predict your future actions. And that's why I think Nietzsche is so, still so unanimously respected and read because he never explicitly stated something. He didn't understand himself, but he had little glimpses of it. I guess like that's why Dostoevsky is so important in Peterson's thought, because we understand everything through story, and we haven't yet come to the point where myth is surpassed by anything in terms of explaining our drives and how different lives pan out. And story is everything. Next time you watch a story, for instance, think of all the objective things that happen in the world of the character that are left out, because all you care about is what happened to the character. What was the most important thing that happened to the character that forced him to do something? And then what was that something that he did in reaction to that? And maybe, how did it affect some of the people in his life? But, you know, there's a lot left out, is my point. When we tell a really, really good story, you know, The Godfather, for instance, I bring that up a lot because I've watched it like 3 times in the past 6 months, I think, because it's so compact and dense, and yet it leaves out so much unimportant information to the story, and that's kind of the opposite of the scientific mindset. So, next time you walk into a room, pay attention to what are the first 3 things you observe about it, and why you observe that, and why didn't you choose to look at, you know, what color the ceiling or a wall is versus where, if it's a classroom, where the teacher's desk is and where all the student seats are. It's because the latter is more relevant to you than the former. So, yeah, myths are certainly not as simple as I used to think they are. So, get some sleep. I hope your dreams are archetypal and you wake up influenced in some unknown way to, again, incrementally change your life towards the better.